there have been two massive explosions at the finish line of the Boston Marathon.
The storefronts have been blown out. There are a massive amount of casualties, she said, lying on the ground on Boylston and in the Exeter-Boylston intersection area.
Police from all across the city right now are being routed down to the finish line. The SWAT teams are on the way. Bomb squads are on the way. I'm being told that they're looking for secondary devices, that there is a big concern. They don't know if there's anything else out there.
We have been told that there are two deaths in these two explosions today, and 22 people have been injured.
A police officer came over and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, I need you all to back up. There's about to be another explosion. We are currently looking for other devices."
And I want to also extend some more information to you right now. As well as this is going on here in Boston, we now understand that Washington, D.C. is on a heightened state of alert. Washington, D.C. on a heightened state of alert. President Obama obviously notified of the explosions here at the finish line. Vice President Biden saying that he is praying for the victims. The president has directed his administration to provide whatever assistance is necessary in the investigation and the response. This is the JFK library. This is smoke from the JFK library explosion. Again, we do not know if this third explosion is related to the two that occurred at the Boston Marathon finish line. Commissioner Ed Davis telling us during his press conference that they are treating it as if it is related.
But again, just look at the pieces. That we were originally told this was an electrical fire. Look at the significant smoke screen from an electrical fire. We have some sound from a witness on the scene back in Boston. Listen to this.
We were standing across from Lord and Taylor, and to our left, toward the finish line, two huge bombs, smoke coming out of buildings, and then something else to the left of us, and the whole thing stopped, and they sent us away.
A big, huge explosion while we were having lunch, and everybody ran for the doors and windows, and we were sheltered under tables.
Yeah, I work in the Prudential, but I don't know what's going on.
We're at the Lenox. We opened a window.
When it hit the elevator, shook the whole building. It was quite a blast. Two of them scared the hell out of us.
What'd I see? I was watching a race, and we heard an explosion. And you know, it was a little bit louder than an M80 or a cherry bomber. And we saw all the smoke was right across the street from us, basically. It was the most serious thing I dealt with being on a fire department in 26 years. It was a terrible scene.
When I made the turn, I mean, it was like the first pop, boom, and then another one, boom, and then another one, boom. It's like one after the other. It was just one big cloud of smoke, white smoke, and then the other one after the other after the other.
Okay.
It was
you
crazy.
Okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. Well, she was in the grandstand, and I was just worried about her, you know?
Yeah.
But, it's bad. This let me tell you, this is really, really bad.
He described three. We have no confirmation of three. We believe that two were at the finish line, and they are trying to determine if the one at JFK is related to this at all. If this is an accidental fire, there was a controlled explosion, but that was a good hour ago. It wasn't near when he was running through.
We want to also share with you that if you are anyway trying to reach a family member, do not use your cell phone to call them in the area. You are asked to call 617-635-4500, which is the mayor's hotline. The official word is that cell phone service has now been shut down in Boston as a result of their concerns that cell phones could potentially set off any other explosions or any other bombs that may be in the area.
Again, people still shaking their heads. They can't believe this has happened here in Boston.
At least 98 people have been taken to hospitals. There are, at Brigham and Women's, people from the teens to the 60s. That is the actual explosion at the moment of the marathon. You can see the number of runners that were on Boylston Street. And from this, there's a second one. And then after the second, there's the second explosion. You can hear the screams and the chaos, people running, abandoning their positions, their backpack. But they, right in the core of that, one would suspect, there were a great number of people. So one would suspect that a lot of the people who were injured were in there. At Brigham and Women's, there are people between the teens to the mid-60s. Right now at BIDMC, there are seven life-threatening injuries, and they're in the operating room right now. Mass General has five in serious condition. So there are a great number of people. Right now, we can confirm the two are dead, and nearly 100 are injured, but those numbers are certainly being affected by what you have, because you can see the scope of the number of people who were on the sidewalk on Boylston Street today.
But here's a map for you to give you a sense of where the finish line is that you're looking at it. Right there is Boylston Street, right there in the center of your screen, and you can see Dartmouth Street to your right and Exeter Street to your left, and that's where the finish line is between those two streets. The Lenox Hotel, if you're looking at this shot, is just right there to the left, and that big square sort of diamond-shaped white roof, that's the Boston Public Library, to give you a sense of where you are. And there you can see where the first explosion happened, right on Boylston Street. We just showed you that video. And then up about a block away, or half a block away, in front of the Lenox Hotel, or just beyond the Lenox Hotel, was where the second explosion occurred 10 seconds later.
Take a look at this. This happened at the JFK Library, and Commissioner Ed Davis of the Boston Police Department said, watch in the middle of your screen. You can see the intense flames, the intensity of the flames in that little dark box area, but you can also see the black smoke just pouring out of there. He would not connect this event to the other event, but he did say that it was an incendiary device. So that would certainly directly state that this was not an accidental fire of any kind. We are learning from the White House tonight that any event with multiple explosive devices, as this appears to be, is clearly an act of terror. It'll be approached as an act of terror. We don't know who carried out the attack right now, and a thorough investigation will have to determine whether it was planned or it was carried out by a terrorist group, foreign or domestic. The point being, it is being treated as a terror incident. Here's what the president said just about a half hour ago.
Good afternoon, everybody. Earlier today, I was briefed by my Homeland Security team on the events in Boston. We're continuing to monitor and respond to the situation as it unfolds, and I've directed the full resources of the federal government to help state and local authorities protect our people.
We want to play some new video that we've gotten of the explosion. Watch and listen to this. That first explosion, if it stopped the runners in their path, but then you could sense confusion. What is it? And then the second explosion, there was heightened screaming. It was intensified screaming, and you could see that the chaos. It's at that point that your mind processed that this was an attack.
Ed, you know, when you were describing that people who were in the middle of all of this didn't know where to go, which way to look, what to do, you're describing the story of Tony Clinton. Take a look at this video. This is home video that he took right after that second explosion. It shows how all of the people who were spectators at the finish line, they heard the first explosion, they looked one way, then just 10 seconds later, another explosion, and they all sort of start running, and they're not sure where to run. There's no one to tell them where to go. They're going down some street. They're saying, is this the right direction? How far should we go? What should we do? In fact, we had a chance to talk to Tony after he shared this video with us, and he talks about how frightening it was being there with his friend and thinking that this could actually be the end for him.
We are like, boom. We turn this way, we only can see a smoke, and we look like nearby, we see bleeding, we see blood and everything. At that time, we tried to run the other direction, and then the second explosion happened the other direction. We feel like we are trapped. At that moment, me and my friend, we just tried to hug each other, and we feel like this is it. We're not going anywhere.
These are pictures of the marathoners stopped And this one, look at the number of just stopped. They've just left Kenmore Square. They're about to come up and take the turn and then meander their way to Boylston Street, and they were stopped. Roughly 4,500 of them just said, "You're not going any further. Turn around and go back."
That's a remarkable sight. Something you never thought you'd see in your lifetime, right?
Never.
This is News Center 5 at 11.
One of Boston's greatest traditions. By terror. The marathon under attack.
Just the bodies on the ground.
Tonight, a city on edge.
Smoke and debris everywhere. You know, across the finish line, screams.
An investigation unfolding.
There is no suspect.
And a nation in disbelief.
We will find out who did this. We'll find out why they did this.
You are looking live at Boylston Street tonight, blocked off by police at this hour, a scene of horror, and tonight the center of a sweeping investigation. Right now, the city is on alert. The nation is on the hunt for whomever set off the bombs, killing three people along the marathon route.
The images that we have been seeing tonight are just simply unforgettable, but they may also hold clues to who did this. That is the moment when everything changed. Just before 3 o'clock this afternoon, two separate explosions along Boylston Street as the runners streamed across the finish line.
At this hour, the death toll stands at 3. One of them is an 8-year-old child. More than 130, in fact, the last number we had was more than 140 people were hurt. Several patients are in critical condition at this hour, and they're undergoing surgery at Boston hospitals.
The view from Sky 5 shortly after the blast shows just some of the damage. The city right now is on high alert. The area around Boylston Street still locked down. But the mayor's office says the city will be open for business tomorrow. So if you work in an area of the city not affected by today's explosions, you can come to work as scheduled tomorrow.
Police and federal agents are swarming all over the city. Police say that there are no suspects tonight, but several people are being questioned at this hour. We have team coverage for you tonight, every angle covered, and we begin with News Center 5, Sean Kelly. Sean?
And Heather, as you mentioned earlier, Boylston Street is completely shut down. We're now moved about 5 blocks from the bomb site. When this happened, we were about a block and a half away. Our van shook when the first bomb went off. This was executed at a point for mass casualties, a point when runners were crowding Boylston, and all of the sidewalks along Boylston were completely crowded as well.
The finish line scattered. Boylston opened for the stretchers and wheelchairs carrying the wounded to rush out.
When I made the turn, I mean, it was like the first pop, boom, and then another one, boom.
Get on the sidewalk.
Next to the blast sites, barriers collapsed into the final 100 yards of the marathon. Firefighters, volunteer medics, and runners tended to more than 100 victims.
Someone in the crowd yelled, like, "Don't panic, don't panic."
The man in this wheelchair had his legs blown off below the knees.
I need to know if he's okay.
Okay, we're gonna get you there right now.
Jerry Dubner was nearing the finish line on the opposite side of Boylston when the bombs went off.
Heard the first explosion and saw the smoke, but didn't really know what to think of it. I kept running, and then all of a sudden there was the second explosion.
And what did you see?
Well, I first felt the shock from the explosion, then looked over in the direction of the explosion and saw some people lying on the ground, saw some blood there.
The area of Boylston Street that you're looking at right now, typically at the time of this bombing, when the race was going on, typically it would be nothing but people drinking water, getting the Mylar blankets on them, trying to cool down or warm up, whichever the case may be, meeting up with families. Time seems to have stood still at this point. No one out there now but police. Vehicles have been removed. The barriers in the middle have been removed along with the tables. This entire area is a crime scene. One thing to keep in mind, that after that first explosion, the first responders who were nearby, the volunteer medics, they were all running to a scene right before the second bomb blew up. So there was the possibility of a third or possibly fourth bombing, and these people were all running to treat people.
Earlier today, we were told that there had been a lot of calls to police with people concerned about suspicious packages. Those are being checked out. Behind us, you can see the area, which is now a crime scene and probably the center of the investigation where all the different law enforcement agencies are gathering. That's where the medical tent was and is now turned into the headquarters, as it were, of the investigation.
My son called me at 3 o'clock on my cell phone, told me he had promised that he was hurt really bad and that he couldn't find his brother or his girlfriend.
Jeff was very seriously injured. Both of his legs were blown off just below the knees.
We are heartbroken at the death of our daughter, Crystal Marie. She was a wonderful person. Everybody that knew her loved her.
There have been several significant developments throughout the day. We've been speaking with federal, state, and local law enforcement sources, and at least one of the two bombs may be a pressure cooker style type bomb that can be detonated by a timer or a remote device. That type of bomb is typically packed with shrapnel like BBs, nails, and other sharp objects.
Right now on Chronicle in High Definition.
Boston's spring ritual, marred by an act of terror. Tonight, the race to find those responsible.
Our mission is clear, to bring to justice those responsible for the Marathon bombing.
The lives lost.
Like, brighten the room up, you know, he had like this like awesome smile.
The survivors' long road to recovery.
Their life will now be divided into two parts, the part before that blast and the part after it.
And the way that all of us can cope with the unspeakable.
Communication and dialogue is like magic.
The Boston Marathon attack, next on Chronicle.
And there they go.
This is the marathon Boston has known for 117 years. In some form or another, a day of sport and celebration and spectacle. Patriots Day, Marathon Monday. And this is what someone did to our day, our event yesterday.
This can't be real.
The finish of the Boston Marathon is a place for people to celebrate. And this was the exact opposite.
Make no mistake. An act of cowardice and of this severity cannot be justified or explained. It can only be answered.
As one spectator said, if the world is connected by 6 degrees of separation, Boston is connected by one. Running or watching the marathon is a community event. In the crowd, on the course, are friends, colleagues, neighbors, relatives, loved ones. In the crowd is the Richard family of Dorchester. 8-year-old Martin fatally wounded.
Yesterday, the terror was brought to the city of Boston. Tragedy was brought to one of our neighborhoods also. This is a close place, the city of Boston. Here we know our neighbors, we grieve for them. We grieve for the little boy who we knew from Dorchester.
In the crowd are the Norden brothers from Stoneham and Wakefield, each losing a leg in the blast. Their mother, Liz, unloading groceries when the call came.
My son called me at 3 o'clock on my cell phone, told me he had promised that he was hurt really bad and that he couldn't find his brother or his girlfriend.
In the crowd, Medford native Crystal Campbell, 29 years old, killed instantly. They are neighbors and friends. In Boston, they are people we know or feel we could know. Marathon Monday, Patriots Day, always our special and shared celebration. And this year, our special and shared grief.
And you are now looking at live pictures from Dorchester, where a vigil is underway for bombing victim Martin Richard. 8-year-old Martin loved to run, to climb, played soccer, basketball, and baseball.
He was at the marathon finish line with his family on Monday, and one of the bomb blasts killed him and seriously injured his sister and mother. News Center 5's Jack Harper spoke with Sean McDonough, who coached Martin in two sports.
Like, brightened the room up, you know, he had like this like awesome smile, these like freckles. He was a cute kid, and he was like, he just like really like so polite and so nice, and it was, that's just like, it's just impossible to like grasp what's like what's going on, you know. Like, he's such like a great kid.
So you had him in the hockey last year?
I had him in hockey from like September all the way through to, we stopped like 4 weeks ago, so he was in floor hockey, you know. He did that, and then I had just found out I was coaching him in baseball this year, so you know, when I called the mom, and she said he was really excited to be on my team and everything, and we were excited to have him because he's a really good athlete. So we're just hoping to have a good season with him. But I guess, you know,
you're a parent.
Yeah.
Can you even fathom all this?
I honestly my prayers go out to the father, because that is like, that's insane. Sorry. That's
right,
like
word.
It's just like, it's just terrible. I can't even imagine, like, it's just too much. Like, I'm at a loss for words. Like, I can't even grasp what's going on.
And this afternoon, we did learn the identity of the other people killed in the bombings. 29-year-old Crystal Campbell had gone with her best friend to take a picture of that friend's boyfriend crossing the finish line on Monday afternoon. Her father, William Campbell, says his daughter was a very caring, very loving person and was Daddy's little girl. And the third person has been identified as a Boston University graduate student. That person's name, though, has not yet been released.
Our first look at the mangled remains at one of the two bombs that caused the death and devastation at the Boston Marathon. These pictures were included in a new FBI security bulletin
that was sent to law enforcement agencies all across the country. Take a look at the next one. It shows one of the mangled, partially exploded pressure cooker bombs from the Boston Marathon explosion. Another shows the shredded backpack in which the bomb was reportedly hidden.
We also have new video tonight high above the scene on Boylston Street, still cordoned off as investigators scour that area for clues. News Center 5's Sean Kelly live on the ground tonight with more of what police revealed. Sean.
Heather, we're a little bit more than a full day into this investigation, and detectives are still here trying to piece together all of these small broken pieces left at the crime scene. Now, what they are attempting to do is to figure out what was here before the explosions and what was packed into those killer bombs.
FBI agents hope someone in the packed marathon crowd remembers seeing a person enter with heavy black nylon bags. Authorities determined that's what was used to carry the explosive devices designed to maim.
Among items partially recovered are pieces of black nylon, which could be from a backpack, and what appear to be fragments of BBs and nails, possibly contained in a pressure cooker device.
Doctors pulled shrapnel from some of the 176 victims. Other larger pieces of metal flew from the scene, suggesting the bombs were possibly hidden under garbage cans. The pressure cooker device like these are crude designs frequently used in Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India.
At this time, there are no claims of responsibility. The range of suspects and motives remains wide open.
A federal forensics team from Quantico, Virginia is here to help detectives study every photograph and frame of cell phone and surveillance video taken near the site. They'll create a timeline to try to see who got through Boston police security undetected.
There are new photos and new insight this midday into the deadly marathon attack. It includes a key piece of evidence now recovered by federal investigators.
Investigators found the lid to one of those pressure cookers up there on the rooftop.
Team 5 Investigates has obtained this aerial photo taken from the rooftop at 755 Boylston Street, just moments after one of the bombs exploded. You can see a tattered backpack. We've also learned investigators have recovered a mangled Fager brand pressure cooker. These can be bought in stores or online.
Sources telling News Center 5 tonight that surveillance cameras from the Lord & Taylor store on Boylston Street captured clear images of a man dropping a package at the scene of the blast.
CNN reporting that there are now two suspects caught on camera in the marathon bombing. We're also learning more tonight about the young BU grad student killed in that explosion. The 23-year-old Lingji Liu was studying to get her master's degree in statistics. She was killed while standing with two friends near the finish line. Liu was a native of China, an only child, and her parents tonight say her death is like a dagger to their hearts. 8-year-old Martin Richard has become one of the symbols of Monday's carnage, but tonight we're learning of the efforts to save his sister.
Tracy Monroe started running. Then, because of the children, she turned and went back.
I saw a little girl laying in the street, and I just sort of held her head in my hands and just rubbed her and tried to comfort her, and I held her hand and tried to just keep her talking to me. And I asked her what her name was, and she said, she just looked up at me and said, Jane.
Jane Richard lay stunned, her leg torn away.
I just imagined that if my daughter were injured like that and I couldn't get to her, I just, like, just the comfort, you know. She was just a baby, and she was so badly injured and so scared, and but she was so incredibly brave. Could see all around
me. In an instant, the day's beauty was shattered. A celebration became a tragedy, and our hearts are broken for 8-year-old Martin, with his big smile and bright eyes. His last hours were as perfect as an 8-year-old boy could hope for, with his family eating ice cream at a sporting event. Our prayers are with the Liu family of China, who sent their daughter Lingzi to BU so that she could experience all that this city has to offer. With you, your country is with you. We will all be with you as you learn to stand and walk and, yes, run again. Of that, I have no doubt you will run again.
After a very detailed analysis of photo, video, and other evidence, we are releasing photos of these two suspects. They are identified as Suspect 1 and Suspect 2. They appear to be associated.
This is News Center 5 at 11.
Suspects in the Boston Marathon attack identified by the FBI. Their images now being viewed around the world. But who are they and where are they?
Suspect number 1, a dark baseball-style cap, dark backpack. Suspect number 2 has a light cap, a lighter-colored backpack. Millions of people are now scouring those images, closely looking at every detail.
The FBI urging people to call in any tips, not to take any personal action tonight. The suspects are believed to be armed and extremely dangerous. 11 minutes of nonstop news begins with our Janet Wu. She's live in Boston. Janet.
Well, after more than 24 hours of speculation and tidbits of leaked information, the FBI tonight publicly set the parameters of its investigation. Now, the agency is not telling us everything it knows, but it has released critical images in hopes that the public fills in the blanks. Suspect number 1, black hat and sunglasses, walking down Boylston Street with a backpack, dressed like many others on that marathon day. The FBI isn't saying why exactly they marked him as a single person of interest more than a day ago. They weren't even sure if he was working alone or in concert with others. But tonight, they called this man in a white hat suspect number 2.
Suspects 1 and 2 appear to be walking together through the marathon crowd on Boylston Street in the direction of the finish line. That image was captured as they walked on Boylston in the vicinity of the intersection with Gloucester Street. The only one who was observed planting what we believe to be the device is suspect number 2 with a white cap. It was shortly before the bomb blast went off.
The FBI did not release the video or photo of suspect number 2 depositing the backpack before walking away. They said suspect number 1 is pictured at the site of the first explosion, but they have no images of him leaving his backpack there.
Somebody out there knows these individuals as friends, neighbors, co-workers, or family members of the suspects. Though it may be difficult, the nation is counting on those with information to come forward and provide it to us. We consider them to be armed and extremely dangerous. No one should approach them. No one should attempt to apprehend them except law enforcement.
Yet Delorier insisted the public is safe, despite the whereabouts of their two main suspects is unknown.
I do stand by that statement right now. There's no additional imminent danger that we are aware of right now.
Now, the FBI cautioned the public not to pay attention to the hundreds of other photos that are floating around on the internet right now purporting to be the suspects. Only those on the FBI website and the ones that you saw here tonight should be the public's guidepost. Reporting live from Boston, Janet Wu, WCVB News Center 5.
We're all looking at the same images of these two suspects, but different clues may stand out to different people. Could it be a detail near one of the suspects, or is it something that perhaps stands out about their clothing or posture? Our live breaking news coverage continues now with News Center 5's Sean Kelly. And Sean, you talked to a terrorism expert tonight. What did he focus on?
Well, immediately he recognized just how many people these two suspects passed along the way, this fairly long walk, and any number of people could have inadvertently taken their picture, which could lead to clues.
We are releasing photos.
The digital dragnet for the bombing suspects has a worldwide reach, 6 still images and 3 video clips, enough for the FBI to think someone will recognize one or both men. The video appears to have been taken from Whiskey Smokehouse's surveillance cameras at the corner of Gloucester and Boylston Streets. At this point, the men are 1.5 to 2 blocks away from the bombing sites. They're walking a few feet away from each other, not paying attention to the runners.
There are a lot of people around the suspects, so you might know somebody who was there who might have taken a picture that they didn't realize included the suspect.
Terrorism expert and Harvard professor Leonard Marcus says people should look closely at every detail: the color of their hats, possible logos, their coats, suspect number 2's nose, and even the innocent people around them.
People might have seen something, or there might be a clue or something they didn't pay attention to, and they put it together and, oh, what do you know?
The time of the video indicates their approach roughly 12 to 13 minutes before detonation. Still images taken of suspect number 2 show him looking around and on his cell phone.
They made a telephone call. Was the telephone call to detonate the bomb, or maybe they were getting instructions from someone?
As much work as this that is still being done in and around the crime scene at this hour, still several blocks away from the impact zone, the best evidence could wind up being these pictures in terms of leading the FBI to the suspects. Live in Copley Square, Sean Kelly, WCVB News Center 5.
Speaking of details, here's one detail that a lot of you have noticed and emailed us about. The woman walking in the video, she's holding yellow balloons. It stands out because so many of you remember this image the moment after the explosion, and you can see yellow balloons rising up into the air. Tonight, the video and the pictures have turned everyone in the world into a detective. And new at 11, billboards are up all across the state, making those images larger than life. Let's get to News Center 5's Jorge Quiroga. He's live in our newsroom tonight. This is all part of the plan, Jorge.
That's right. Tonight, those pictures are all over TV and the internet, and that's exactly what the FBI was hoping for.
Within hours of this,
today we are enlisting the public's help to identify the two suspects.
There was this. Millions of people inspecting the images online trying to help.
Here's another one. Have we determined if white hat guy, suspect 2, walked past bomb site?
Moving twice the speed of mainstream media with the added lure that social media is interactive and engaging.
We have some breaking news into News Center 5. Liz Bruner along with Ed Harding right now. There has been an officer at the MIT campus in Cambridge who has been shot this evening.
The latest information at this hour coming out of state police saying that this officer does have life-threatening injuries. Now, we did confirm from the police here on campus, MIT police, that this officer is an officer that works for the MIT police campus. So that is what we know at this point. We know that shots were fired at 10:48 here around building number 32, which we understand is that building with the glass windows. What I can tell you is that people are certainly on high alert. There's definitely a sense of anxiety in the air.
The officer suffered multiple gunshot wounds. He was transported to Mass General Hospital, where he was pronounced dead. At this point in time, we are unaware of any other victims. No arrests have been made. We do know that the Massachusetts State Police patrols, the canine air wing, detectives and crime scene technicians have all responded to this scene at MIT. And now they have, it appears, there have been many other sirens and police vehicles responding to possibly, according to Cambridge police, the report of a suspicious package at Mass Avenue and Pleasant Streets. And we also know there's been activity at the Charles MGH station, which is located at Cambridge Street and Charles Streets at the end of the Longfellow Bridge on the Boston side. So there is a lot of activity going on.
I've just been given some information, and I want to be very careful as I give this information. If you are in Watertown, You are being asked to stay off the roads. Suddenly, within a short period of time, this immediate car chase developed, a carjacking developed, which took it from Cambridge into Watertown.
Well, we learned
now, are they connected? That's the question.
So
now, we were hearing multiple reports of possibly three suspects, and then it became two armed suspects that had carjacked this Mercedes and had had a passenger that they had kidnapped in that Mercedes for some time. The passenger was released, told police that these were armed, this was an armed carjacking.
Let's bring you up to date now. The situation happening right now at this moment is in Watertown, where there is, according to state police, a crime scene that is scattered throughout about a 20-block area there, but they are stressing they're searching that area and beyond. They are looking for the second bombing suspect who is believed to be on foot, maybe injured after this shootout with police that unfolded near Laurel and Dexter Street. A shootout that one witness tells us here at News Center 5 lasted for several minutes. Hundreds of shots were fired as one suspect was on the ground dying. The second suspect screeched off in a black Mercedes SUV. But right now we're also hearing from Sean Kelly on the scene that there was a MBTA bus brought into that area near School Street. It's been positioned there possibly to evacuate residents if need be. Until then, police just want you, if you're in Watertown, to stay indoors and call 911 if you see anything suspicious.
And obviously a lot of people are probably feeling the need to try to get to work today. If you live in Watertown, it's the best idea to stay in your home. If you have to leave, you really should be doing that with police escort, and I think that they are making some accommodations to be able to get people out of there.
We are in lockdown here in Boston, and I certainly haven't seen anything like this. I know when I was in Boston earlier today, just looking at the streets, they were empty. Mass Avenue, that bridge between Boston and Cambridge, which is always so full of traffic, completely empty. This is Huntington Avenue. As you can see, hardly any cars.
The manhunt continues at this hour, and it is focused almost entirely in Watertown this evening.
Sean Kelly has been in Watertown since this happened around, you know, whatever, 12:30, quarter one in the morning. The timeline begins to blur. And Sean, quite frankly, you said something a little bit ago that I think a lot of us are feeling. How, if he did manage to get away, how did that happen?
Especially when you look at this kind of force that's coming into this area. What we did see earlier was the towing of two different vehicles from the neighborhood here. The first was a green Honda Civic, which was believed to be the one of the vehicles used through the course of the night last night, and specifically one of the vehicles used here at the scene, at the shooting scene, by the two suspects.
In light of the status of the investigation here in Watertown and the developments in the course of the day, the stay indoors request is lifted. The T is open, effective immediately, the MBTA, effective immediately. We are asking the public to remain vigilant if you are out. Continue to be alert to suspicious activity, unaccompanied or unattended packages and backpacks and so on. Remember, there is still a very, very dangerous individual at large.
We are hearing of massive explosions in Watertown. So Kelly Tuthill, what's going on, Kel?
Ed, I can barely talk. This is a very volatile situation here. We just heard gunfire. The police are telling us to get down. There's guns drawn. There's definitely something happening here. I'm going to pull back a little bit. I'm trying to obviously be conscious of my own safety. There's definitely multiple shots fired. We're fine. It's just we're very close to the action. And actually, I won't say even what street I'm on. Let's not say what street I'm on because okay. We don't know the status of the investigation. We're in the town of Watertown. That's all I will tell you.
Right.
What can you hear, Kelly?
All of a sudden, we got a call. We heard on the radio that they were looking at a report of blood. We believe it was on a boat. So then the question was there someone hiding? I'm going to pull back more. They're telling us to get back further, and I'm going to listen to them because we don't know what we're dealing with.
All right, as you move back, are you still hearing gunfire?
No, there's no gunfire right now. I'm going to take for my house and just be safe about this.
Take a breath.
Now,
I'm fine. Did you hear explosions?
The report came that there was blood on a boat at a property, like a house. So everybody convened all at once in a certain neighborhood not far from where we've been. And then we heard an explosion of gunfire. We have no idea what the status is. We can tell you there are heavily armed officers all over. There's a helicopter flying above. And I don't know what happened, obviously, because as soon as we got close, they told us to get back. And we don't need to be told twice.
One law enforcement source very close to this investigation is now telling me that a body has been found in the backyard on Franklin Street in Watertown.
Sean Kelly, you can further this along for us.
As we were getting into position, we heard rapid gunfire. Now we're looking at state police moving into the scene. All of the helicopters are overhead right now. We know that the tactical unit is on their way in. We're also hearing reports of three ambulances on the way to the scene now.
Dozens and dozens of police officers rushing to the scene. I heard one just motion to the other one, gas. You're going to see gas.
Okay, and what we're looking at, Kelly, on the screen right now, we're not going to give the address again, but what we are looking at is a house that clearly has a boat in the backyard.
Bang. There's two more. And another bang.
And another one. Yep.
Kathy Curran, Newton Police just tweeted, white hat captured. That's how they're referring to him, white hat.
The white hat man has been captured, and we are hearing from law enforcement sources that he is in fact alive. He is on his way to a local hospital.
It's over. Cheers from a community once under siege, now breathing a sigh of relief at 11 o'clock.
The target of a massive manhunt captured. The man accused of planting one of the deadly bombs at the Boston Marathon alive and in custody. Tonight we are hearing from a survivor who was just about as close to the explosion as you can get. This picture shows the scene of the first blast, and that store with the windows blown out is Marathon Sports, and workers inside right there risked their own lives to save others that day. News Center 5's Mary Saladin is live in Boston with the incredible firsthand account. Mary?
Yeah, Heather, we're also on Boylston Street tonight. The other end from Sean, it is still blocked off and empty, as you can see. But, you know, last Monday, so many people found themselves here smack dab in the middle of the blast zone.
And as soon as the sound went off, I just knew that was a bomb.
Shane O'Hara is a manager at the Marathon Sports Store on Boylston Street. He stood just feet from the glass windows last Monday as the first bomb went off.
The first thing I did is I ran to the door and just tried to get people inside.
This photo captured O'Hara at that moment.
The first woman that I saw, definitely very distracted. And was aiding to her, and then I heard tourniquets. We need tourniquets. So then I ran back inside, and we just started taking any piece of apparel.
Co-workers, bystanders, even runners who just crossed the finish line did the same.
There was a lot of other real citizens out there that were aiding to that and helping and seeing, again, things that we weren't trained to see or ever want to see.
On this sunny afternoon, Red Sox Nation showed its gratitude to the survivors of the marathon bombings and how they selflessly came to the aid of others. O'Hara admits he's been haunted by the sights and sounds of that afternoon, but he came to Fenway anyway today with his co-workers, with resolve and hope.
This is for a city, this is for a country, that we will survive.
Shane O'Hara, just one of many bombing survivors, now trying to heal from the emotional wounds from last Monday.
Bombing victim Crystal Campbell was laid to rest in Medford today. A memorial service for MIT police officer Sean Collier takes place on Wednesday. It has been a week of great sadness and soothing words.
As his clock struck that fateful hour, love has covered this resilient city. I have never loved it and its people more than I do today.
We come today to thank God for the police and firefighters, the National Guard, for the doctors and nurses, for all who responded selflessly and courageously.
Everywhere.
I saw a little girl laying in the street, and I just sort of held her head in my hands and just rubbed her and tried to comfort her, and I held her hand and tried to just keep her talking to me. And I asked her what her name was, and she said, she just looked up at me and said, Jane.
I'm thankful for the countless numbers of people in this proud city and this storied Commonwealth who, in the aftermath of such senseless violence, let their first instinct be kindness.
We love the fathers and the brothers who took shirts off their backs to stop the bleeding. The mothers and the sisters who cared for the injured. The neighbors and the business owners, the homeowners all across the city. They opened their doors and their hearts to the weary and the scared.
The generous and courageous response of so many assures us that there resides in people's hearts a goodness that is incredibly selfless.
Every one of us has been touched by this attack on your beloved city. Every one of us stands with you. Because after all, it's our beloved city too. I know this because there's a piece of Boston in me. You welcomed me as a young law student across the river. Welcomed Michelle too. Like you, Michelle and I have walked these streets. Like you, we know these neighborhoods. It's personal. You've shown us, Boston, that in the face of evil, Americans will lift up what's good. In the face of cruelty, we will choose compassion. In the face of those who would visit death upon innocence, we will choose to save and to comfort and to heal. We'll choose friendship. We'll choose love.
The words of leaders and the comfort of faith. Still hard to watch a little bit.
Breaking news that you'll see only on 5 tonight.
I know people say there's blood on the boat, that he saw blood and went in. Not true. Not true.
Now, the word is you saw the boat, you pulled back the wrapping, you saw a body, it moved, and you called 911.
Oh, no.
No.
This man found the bombing suspect number 2 hiding in his boat in his backyard, and he says, you haven't heard the real story of what happened next. But first, the new developments in the investigation into the Boston Marathon attacks.
Just hours ago, Boylston Street reopened to residents and businesses for the first time since the attack on Patriots Day. Plus, 2 more victims laid to rest today. The youngest victim, 8-year-old Martin Richard, buried in a private service, along with MIT police officer Sean Collier, allegedly gunned down by the suspects in the hours after the bombing. And the number of injured is rising tonight. It's closer to 300 now as more people seek medical care. Meanwhile, suspect number 2, Dzhokhar Tsarnaev, has been upgraded to fair condition.
And tonight, only on 5, we are hearing the untold story of Tsarnaev's takedown, exclusively from the man who found him hiding in his boat. I talked to Dave Henneberry today, emotional at times, away from his home, which is still part of a crime scene at this hour.
the people killed can get some from.
They, you know, in many ways, they do.
Then I'm at peace with it, you know.
The sequence of events that Friday night, still very raw.
This hits you more afterwards when you think, my God, we probably slept last night. This guy could be in that, you know, I don't know. It's just, it's surreal.
When Dave Henneberry found suspect number two.
And I look in the boat over here on the floor. And I see blood. And
a lot of blood?
Good amount of blood.
Yeah.
And I said, wow, did I cut myself last time I was in the boat a couple weeks ago and forget the, no, you know. No. Then I just looked over there and there's more blood on the forward part on the floor. And I looked back and forth to those things a couple times. Then my eyes went to the other side of the engine box. The engine box is in the middle of the box. There was a body.
In his boat.
I know people say there was blood on the boat, and he saw blood and went in. Not true. Not true.
Now, the word is you saw the boat, you pulled back the wrapping, you saw a body, it moved, and you called 911.
Oh, no.
No.
No, no, no.
The man the world was looking for.
Well, I know I took three steps up the ladder. I don't remember stepping down off the ladder. I think I just...
And then you run in the house.
Yeah.
And immediately call 911. What do you say to 911?
Remember, live on...
Franklin Street
in Watertown. I just went out. I looked in my boat, and there's a body in the boat. There's a body in the boat. There's somebody in the boat, and there's blood in the boat.
The shots were fired. Dave and his wife were safely back, but his boat was riddled.
All the generosity of people saying, we got to get this guy another boat because he loves the boat. How's that make you feel?
It makes me feel wonderful that people are thinking like that. But it's a boat, and there's people that have lost lives and lost limbs. The money goes there, into the Boston One Fund.
I got a canoe in the garage. There are two words that he wants to leave with you tonight. Thank you. Thank you to Ed Davis for what he did. Thank you to Ed Devereaux of Watertown for what he did. Thank you to the Watertown Police and Fire Departments for what they did. The man is very thankful, and he's sharing his story with you tonight.
And we're thankful to hear from him, Ed. Thank you. Tonight, we are learning more about suspect number two, Dzhokhar Dzunayev. Right now, he is listed in fair condition at Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center. And that's where we find News Center 5's Kelly Cuthill with new details tonight. Kelly?
Well, as the other news tonight is that he's cooperating with authorities here at Beth Israel. Dzhokhar Dzunayev's been upgraded to fair condition, treated for gunshot wounds to his head, neck, legs, and hand under the watch of U.S. Marshals. ABC News reports the 19-year-old is telling authorities his version of the events before and after the deadly Marathon Day bombings. Dzunayev has reportedly told investigators the attack was spawned by material found on the internet and that he and his brother had no direction or financing from governments or extremist groups overseas. Tamerlan, who was 26, is emerging as the plot's mastermind and did much of the work putting it together. According to ABC, his younger brother Dzhokhar may not have known about the plot until the week before. The FBI first looked into Tamerlan Dzunayev in 2011 at the request of Russian authorities, concerned he was a follower of radical Islam. But investigators concluded he was not a threat.
All of us here are committed to finding out why this happened, what more we can do to prevent attacks like this in the future, and making sure those responsible for this unconscionable act of terror face justice.
And the White House confirming, reiterating today that their investigation goes well beyond the events here in Boston of the last week. They are looking once again at those reports the Russian government tipped off the U.S. government back in 2011 about concerns with one of the suspects. Live at Beth Israel, I'm Kelly Tuthill, WCVB News Center 5.
The manager of Phantom Fireworks in Seabrook, New Hampshire, says that suspect number one bought two mortar kits at the store in February. April Walton says Tamerlan Dzunayev bought the two lock and load reloadable mortar kits with 24 shells in each. Company officials say FBI agents interviewed staffers there on Friday. They tell us the amount of gunpowder in the kits would not have been enough to detonate the Boston bombs. Team 5 investigates now, and our Kathy Curran talking exclusively with the MIT police chief. One of his officers was gunned down by the bombing suspects at the beginning of their final rampage. And Kathy, how is he handling this heartbreaking loss?
Obviously a tough, tough time, Ed. Chief John DeFava told me Sean Collier was put on this earth to be a police officer. It's a very difficult time for the chief, his department, and the MIT community. It was 10:20 Thursday night when those deadly shots rang out. Chief DeFava had left the campus about an hour before.
They killed a good, good man. He was a good man. This department is devastated. MIT is devastated. He died in a very, very violent way.
MIT Police Chief John DeFava is devastated and frustrated by the loss of 26-year-old Officer Sean Collier, one of the youngest members of his department, who he says was tailor-made to be a cop. Collier was known around campus for his warm smile and dedication to policing. DeFava saw Sean sitting in his cruiser on Vassar Street Thursday night, close to where he was killed about an hour before the deadly shots rang out at MIT.
I said, what are you doing? You know, so just conversationally. And he says, Chief, just making sure everybody's behaving themselves. And I said something stupid back, and he gave me that grin. And I says, I'll see you later, and I left. An hour later, I got the phone call. He had been shot.
DeFava can't comment on the investigation, but sources tell Team 5 Investigates the two Marathon bombing suspects came out of nowhere and approached from behind on the passenger side of Collier's cruiser. The officer's window was down when multiple shots were fired at close range.
I can't make sense of it. I can't make sense of their anger. I can't make sense of the hate. I can't make sense of why they did what they did at the Marathon. I certainly can't make sense of why they killed our officer.
And multiple sources have told Team 5 the suspects did not get Officer Collier's department-issued gun, but from the looks of the holster, someone was trying to grab it. For Team 5 Investigates, I'm Kathy Curran.
A tribute to Sean Collier in Stoneham, the MIT police officer laid to rest, but never to be forgotten. News Center 5's Jack Harper is live at MIT, where the campus is in mourning tonight. Jack?
Several tributes growing in several towns, including here at the MIT office, Liz. Hundreds of people have come by, dropped off flowers and messages. And as you can see, a lot of them are school kids concerned about the officer. Up in Stoneham today, a private service.
They assassinated him. He had no chance. And it's hard to even comprehend. And I'm tired of having to explain it to my kids.
It was miserable, misty, but memorable. For Officer Sean Collier's family, a few friends, and fellow officers, this was private time to remember the young cop. Some who didn't know him paid their respects outside.
It's heartbreaking. Like, I know it's such a cliche, but that's the only word I can come up with that's appropriate.
Heather Teague brought 10-year-old Brendan to the church.
And it was important, I think, for me to show Brendan what this is all about and how much appreciation we owe to the officers.
Sean Collier's mother, Kelly, heard words of support from Cardinal O'Malley. His brother was hugged over and over again. They drove his cruiser to the church. His pride and joy pickup was a flower vehicle. Nice gestures on an awful day.
So it's been difficult to try to explain it, particularly where I don't understand it myself. I don't understand why anyone would do this.
We will be bringing you live coverage of the memorial to Officer Collier tomorrow. That ceremony is scheduled to begin at 12 noon.
The youngest Marathon bombing victim was also laid to rest today. 8-year-old Martin Richard of Dorchester was buried in a private ceremony. The Richard family released a statement this morning saying, and I'm quoting, "The outpouring of love and support over the last week has been tremendous. This has been the most difficult week of our lives, and we appreciate that our friends and family have given us space to grieve and heal." A private funeral mass was celebrated this morning with the immediate family. We laid our son, Martin, to rest. He is now at peace. The family plans to hold a public memorial sometime in the next few weeks.
The barriers come down as Boylston Street reopens, a major step along the way as Boston heals. First on 5, the woman who stood this close to the accused Marathon bomber and somehow survived the deadly blast. Roseanne Zedoya is recovering from devastating injuries, but she is determined to fight back. Our Kathy Curran has an interview you'll see only on 5.
When that bomb went off,
I did look down, and there was a pool of blood. It was quickly filling. I was like, if this is coming from me, I'm going to die.
Roseanne Sedoya closed her eyes and focused on breathing to stay alive while she was on the ground in the aftermath of the explosion of the second bomb on Boylston Street.
To let them know that I was alive, I'd open my eyes and say, I'm here, and then close them again because I just did not want to see any more of the tragedy that had happened.
You can see Roseanne just over the right shoulder of the runner in this picture where she was waiting for friends to cross the finish line. Bombing suspect Johar Tsarnaev is behind her, the bomb right under her feet. Her leg had to be amputated above the knee. She has burns on her arm and staples in her stomach.
I honestly haven't thought of what they did to me. And I don't really have any hatred. At least not at this point.
Right now, Roseanne's focus is on healing. A visit from a Boston firefighter who helped save her life brings some joy, and support from friends, family, and a city that is still strong is the best medicine she could ask for.
It's actually a force behind me, knowing that I have so much of this love that I can't quit.
Roseanne has never been a quitter. I've known her for many years. Her spirit is infectious, and even in the midst of coping with this horrific tragedy, her strength is inspiring.
When, you know, I found out, I broke down. But then in the back of my head, I was like, this is Roseanne, and we know what you're made of.
I can do it. I can do it. I'm Boston strong.
For WCVB News Center 5, I'm Kathy Curran.
Inspiration, Roseanne. She has one unanswered question tonight. Who put the tourniquet on her? She'd like to meet that person and thank them personally. Her friends and family have set up a fund to help her. And to learn how to donate to that or to the One Fund Boston, just go to WCVB.com.
We're learning much more about what happened during that chaotic manhunt for the marathon bombing suspects Thursday night. Multiple sources tell us an investigation is underway on whether or not a state trooper was firing at Boston police officer Kenny Conley and state police lieutenant Dan Wells, who were on patrol together in an unmarked state police truck. Sources tell Team 5 investigates more than 10 rounds were fired at the officer and trooper from behind during the manhunt. The truck was hit, but no one was hurt. A state police spokesperson confirms they're looking at all of the ballistics at that scene, and the Middlesex District Attorney's Office is investigating. Sources are also telling us an investigation is underway to see if MBTA Transit Police Officer Richard Donahue was hit by friendly fire. Team 5 has also learned the investigation into the marathon bombings took federal investigators to a Williams-Sonoma store in Salem, New Hampshire, after receiving a tip from a store clerk. The clerk said two suspicious young men visited the store within the past 6 months looking for a certain type of pressure cooker. Now, no sale was made at that store, but after the marathon bombings, the clerk called the federal tip line but couldn't positively identify the men as the bombing suspects. Williams-Sonoma tells us they have fully cooperated with the investigation. For Team 5 Investigates, I'm Kathy Curran.
Well, right now, this is the marathon bombing suspects' new home, a federal prison medical center at the former Fort Devens. And new at 6 tonight, News Center 5's Jorge Quiroga is there live with a closer look at the facility and the people that are being held there. Jorge?
Liz, the name says it's a federal medical facility, but make no mistake about it, you can see the guard across the road keeping us at a distance. This is a high security prison hospital. The younger and surviving marathon bomb suspect was moved early today from his hospital bed at Beth Israel Medical Center to this federal prison hospital. People working in the high-tech office park surrounding the facility couldn't help but notice.
I heard in the news that the bomber number two may be here, so I made it a point to look down there, and lo and behold, there was all of the TV stations.
Johar Tsarnaev, the 19-year-old, transferred under heavy guard by U.S. Marshals. The Federal Medical Center in Devens is located 39 miles west of Boston, along Route 2. On the decommissioned Fort Devens military base, it is run by the Federal Bureau of Prisons for specialized and long-term care. It houses some 1,000 federal inmates with different security classifications, from white-collar criminals to hardcore mobsters, and now possibly the youngest, a suspected terrorist.
People who live or work in the area say the bombing suspect, so nearby, links them to the Marathon Horror.
I was surprised, I guess, that in such a small community like this, all of a sudden you're in the middle of the Boston trouble.
I'm glad that he is caught and that he is going to recover and that we can learn more information.
Now, this sprawling prison hospital sits on what used to be a former military training ground. The village, now known as Devens, straddles three towns, and while there are a number of high-tech companies within it, only 130 people actually live here. Live from Devens, Jorge Quiroga, WCVB News Center 5.
This is WCVB News Center 5 at 11.
Three suspects held without bail, jailed tonight in connection with the Boston Marathon attack. All 19 years old, all accused of obstructing justice, all friends of the man at the center of the investigation. Did they conspire to help Johar Tsarnaev? Prosecutors are building their case tonight.
Three college friends facing serious prison time, a backpack full of fireworks, a critical piece of evidence. We have live team coverage from South Boston to the South Coast. And let's begin with our Sean Kelly. He's live at the Moakley Courthouse tonight. Sean?
Federal court documents say the three Russian friends, including marathon bombing suspect Johar Tsarnaev, became close at UMass Dartmouth. So close, according to the FBI, that Azamat Tazayakov and Dias Kardyubayev tried to ditch key evidence for their buddy during the intense manhunt. Court documents say the teenage nationals from Kazakhstan became concerned for their friend after recognizing his picture released by the FBI. The Thursday after the bombings, agents say the college teens, along with another friend, Robel Filipos, went to Tsarnaev's dorm and grabbed his backpack with a laptop, fireworks with removed gunpowder, and Vaseline inside. Investigators say Azamat and Dias believe Tsarnaev used those items to make a bomb.
As we've said from the very beginning, he assisted the FBI in this investigation. He is just as shocked and horrified by the violence in Boston that took place as the rest of the community is.
The young men reportedly brought the bag to their apartment in New Bedford before throwing it in a nearby dumpster. Agents recovered the bag, Vaseline, and empty fireworks. They wouldn't say if the laptop was ever located.
Can't comment today, folks. Sorry.
Filipos faces up to 8 years in prison for allegedly lying to the FBI. The Russian roommates face up to 5 years in prison for dumping evidence.
I'm not sure a 19-year-old college student understands the gravity of a situation like this. And they did not intentionally or knowingly destroy evidence.
There was nothing said in court today and nothing at all in the court documents to even suggest that any of these three new suspects knew anything at all about the plans to bomb the Boston Marathon. Live at the courthouse, Sean Kelly, WCVB News Center 5.
We have new video tonight showing the raid that ended with the arrest of two of the new suspects. This happened in New Bedford on the same night that the accused bomber was found in Watertown. And the agents clearly thought that Johar Tsarnaev might be with them. Listen. Now, this location is not far from UMass Dartmouth, where all three suspects arrested today all took classes. Let's get to our Rondella Richardson. She's live on campus tonight. Rondella?
That's right, Ed. The three in court today were or had been students at this campus taking classes in 2011 with Tsarnaev. But there's another student we caught up with who hadn't been mentioned, that suspect two's roommate who is still enrolled.
Johar Tsarnaev's roommate, giving only a first name of Andrew, is the UMass Dartmouth student tonight meeting off campus with a friend who's an attorney. Andrew tells News Center 5 the FBI and state police questioning has been intense, but he knew nothing of the bombing plot that started in the Pinedale dorm room he shared with suspected bomber Tsarnaev.
I met Johar last year. I mean, it's unreal. It's unreal to think about, especially given the magnitude of the events.
Outside of that dorm, students were saddened and disappointed to learn three young men connected to the university were hauled into court and charged with obstructing justice.
It was shocking, you know.
Current student Akhmet Gnayakov on the left and former students Dias Karabayev and Robel Filipos are accused of taking evidence from Tsarnaev's third floor dorm room to hide their friend's involvement in the bombing.
It's definitely suspect.
Akhmet and Dias, both 19 and from Kazakhstan, were detained a week ago for violating student visas. Tonight, the close friends of the bombing suspect number two are alleged conspirators.
I just felt unsafe knowing that there was,
possible bombs in the room and stuff like that. And, you know, that after being promised that we were safe and stuff, they're still here.
I don't know. I just hope there's not more.
And we know Tsarnaev was back on campus right after the bombing, taking classes, going to the gym. The only other student still taking classes, Ahmad. He has since been suspended, pending the outcome of the investigation. And that roommate, Andrew, he had the U.S. Attorney's Office paperwork, and he was going through line by line. He now has a new room on campus. Live at UMass Dartmouth, Rondella Richardson, WCBB News Center 5.
Hi, my name is Robert Filippos, and
That's YouTube video of the Cambridge teenager accused of making false statements to investigators. He is facing up to 8 years in prison. News Center 5's Jorge Quiroga is live in Cambridge tonight. Jorge?
Heather, he's 19 years old, a naturalized U.S. citizen. Robel Filippos lives in that building behind us along Memorial Drive with his mom. He was the first of the three new suspects to recognize Jokhard Tsarnaev's photo on TV. He now stands to do the most time behind bars.
Hi, my name is Robert Filippos.
The big smile on his YouTube video belies the big trouble. 19-year-old Robel Filippos is now in.
Just saw some state troopers, some FBI taking him out, about four or five law enforcement guys.
The FBI alleges Robel and the two Kazakhstan friends removed the backpack, seven emptied firework tubes, and a computer from Jokhard Tsarnaev's dorm room at UMass Dartmouth. The other two are charged with tossing the marathon bombing evidence into a dumpster. Robel for repeatedly lying to the FBI.
Surprised about the news?
I know I am. I'm devastated, but what can you do?
Filippos was born in Ethiopia. He has lived here for some 10 years.
Normal kids, cool guy. He's a very nice boy.
Robel graduated from Cambridge Ringen Latin with Jokhard, the younger of the two bombing suspects in 2011, becoming a lot closer at UMass Dartmouth. Ron Teckley says Robel wanted to be successful.
He put work before anything, you know what I'm saying? He didn't go outside too much, didn't go to parties.
Filippos was studying marketing but wasn't currently enrolled.
No.
At the basketball court where Robel hung out when he did go out, friends can't believe it.
I know he's going to be scared in there.
Now, by coincidence, that building right there, that's where Robel lives. And look right here at the corner, right next door, that's the mobile gas station where Danny, the carjack victim, ran to for help after he managed to get away from the two suspected bombers. His call to police that night set off the massive manhunt. Live in Cambridge, Jorge Quiroga, WCVB, News Center 5.
There is some news tonight about the transit police officer who was nearly killed in a shootout with the Tsarnaev brothers. Officer Richard Donahue released this new picture of him, along with his wife, and with it a statement thanking the police, first responders, and doctors who saved his life.
So much was taken away the day the two bombs exploded in Boston. One of the most severely injured was 34-year-old Mark Fukeril of Stoneham. And new tonight, he tells our J.C. Monahan about who kept him going in his darkest hour and why he's optimistic about the future.
Man, what's going on, Poppy?
Buddy.
Love you.
A lot of love surrounds the bed of Mark Fukeril. In the moments after he was injured, Mark thought only of his family, especially his fiancée, Jen, and their 5-year-old son, Gavin. Mark lost his right leg, severely injured his left, and has burns up and down his back. Still, his memory of that day is shockingly clear. He can describe the feeling of the firefighter struggling to stop the bleeding in his leg.
It was a quiet, weird quiet. And I was thinking, just hear him yelling. So all I was hearing him was yelling, telling people what to do. I need tourniquets. I need blankets.
He vividly remembers the feeling of being put in the back of a police van with another victim.
All of a sudden, the door shut. She screams. So I scream. So we both like a panic. And now it's like the guy says it was like the first time I yelled or even moaned about pain or anything. But it was more that I was scared because it was dark. Because I thought I was dead. I thought it was over.
Jen tears up, remembering that first call to Mark after the bombs, looking to find out if he and his friends were okay.
So I called and the firefighter answered. And I thought it was James. I thought it was Bim. And I said, come on, Bim, put him on the phone. It's not funny anymore. And he said, ma'am, I'm so sorry, but you need to get to Mass General Hospital now.
Since then, family and friends have rallied around Mark, this teddy bear given to him by his son to keep him company. But it's Gavin's picture that gives him strength.
And that's all I wanted to see. So every time they stuck me with another needle, or they cut me, or they put something or did something, when the ripping change of bands, I was looking at that picture. That's what got me through it.
You can feel the BBs popping through his skin and other shrapnel still embedded in his arm. He has many more surgeries ahead and a long road of recovery.
He's going to be fine. We know it. You know, he's got, it'll be a little bit different, but it's going to be fine.
J.C. Monahan reporting for us. Mark also credited another victim, a victim that we have shown her story with you here on News Center 5, Roseanne Sadoria, with urging him to think about his fiance as they were both being driven to the hospital. And his older brother, Eddie, you saw Eddie in that piece, has postponed his June wedding because he wants the best man, Mark, standing beside him, and he will be standing.
As Boston heals from the marathon attacks, we're still getting stories of emotional rescue reunions. One of them happened just a short time ago. Our Kimberly Bookman is live outside the Spalding Rehab Hospital in Charlestown to tell us all about it. Kimberly?
Pam, this is one we're glad to say we had a hand in. When we posted this picture online this week, well, people started calling in and telling us exactly who this Redding man is. We were able to unite this man with the woman that he saved after the marathon, and today they had a reunion inside Spalding Rehab and recapped what they went through together.
Grinning from ear to ear, this is the first big smile Shore Salter has managed since Marathon Monday.
It was just really awesome.
After News Center 5 put the 20-year-old Northeastern college student in touch with the Drakett woman he helped during the bombings, they reunited for the first time today.
It's just nice and a little peace of mind to see how well she's doing with it and just see her spirit. It's honestly, like, amazing.
Roseanne Sadoya lost a leg in the attack. In this picture, you can see one of the bombing suspects behind her and the explosive-filled backpack under her feet. Shore Salter, a stranger, ran to her rescue and used a belt as a tourniquet to stop the bleeding. But the two got separated when first responders rushed her to the hospital. She asked us for help in locating her hero.
I count my blessings that one individual pulled me from the sidewalk and started the tourniquet on my leg. And I wish I knew who that person was.
We posted his picture online and within minutes got information identifying Shore Salter. Today, he entered Spalding Rehab, hugged Roseanne, and met with the police and firefighter also on the scene that day. He says Roseanne thanked him with this Boston Strong t-shirt.
And I thanked her as well, just for being part of it and being strong for everyone in Boston. But hopefully Roseanne will be a lifelong friend now, and hopefully we'll be able to see a lot more of each other.
This burial plot in Connecticut is one of at least a handful being offered up to the family of Tamerlan Tsarnaev. But so far, no decision has been made about where to bury the marathon bombing suspect. And Worcester police say it is costing taxpayers money. News Center 5's Mary Saladna is live outside the funeral home where the body is currently being held. Mary?
Yeah, Liz, the police chief here estimates that the security overtime alone is costing about $30,000 at this point, but the discussion over who will foot that bill will have to wait because priority number one is finding a final resting place for the body, and there is word tonight there may be some progress.
The uncle of Tamerlan Tsarnaev arrived late afternoon. There's a real push to find a burial site. Even the Worcester police chief is now involved in hinting at progress.
Within the next few days, we're optimistic that there'll be a solution to this problem. There's been a lot of phone calls made trying to find a location. There's a few options on the table, and we're going to pursue them.
Authorities won't give specifics. They'll only say locations both local and abroad are being considered. The mother of Tamerlan Tsarnaev wants him buried in her native province of Dagestan in southern Russia. But funeral director Peter Steffen says he doesn't think Russian officials want the body, and neither does anyone else here in the U.S.
As I've said the whole time, we're just burying a dead body. We're not burying a cause. We're not doing anything else.
Steffen has had over 120 offers from people all over the country and Canada who want to provide graves. But the cities and towns where those graves are located have said no thanks, fearful of the kind of public outcry we've seen here in Worcester.
He's a terrorist. He killed a kid and a cop.
I don't doubt that he did, but I believe he has the right to be buried.
Nah, for the first time today, demonstrators came out in favor of taking the high ground, saying it's time to show mercy to the dead.
I don't know where he was buried.
Now, the funeral director here has said that as a resident of Cambridge, Tamerlan Tsarnaev has a legal right to be buried there. Is that still one of the options on the table? No one here is saying.
The stories that you have not heard. First responders opening up tonight about the chaotic moments after the marathon bombings and rushing toward that danger. News Center 5's Sean Kelly sat down with them tonight.
Heather, Marathon Monday had always been an exciting and fun day for EMTs and paramedics, so many of them in the same place, mostly dealing with sports injuries. And everything was perfect until 2:49. That's when years and years of training was put to the ultimate test.
Once the first blast occurred, you could almost feel the strength, its power, and the second one you feel further down. After the second one, you knew there was something going on.
It was just, you know, a matter of seconds before we started getting updates on the radio that we did have devices explode.
For the first time publicly, EMS first responders were called the seconds, minutes, and hours after the marathon bombings.
Having two loud eruptions like that very close together where you don't expect them, I'm sure, made everybody take a deep breath.
Did you all know where to go?
Where the noise was.
Yeah. Some EMTs and paramedics went directly to the bomb sites, knowing there could be more.
Of course, it was on everybody's mind going there. Everyone who went into that area who had any kind of training knew that there was a potential.
The hardest part was just, you know, not knowing if we're all going to go home safe that night.
They saw more people critically injured in one spot than ever before.
When I was coming down, they were just opening up, but they were running towards me, and I was running. I drove down, and when I got down to Exeter and Boylston, I found three people laid out with amputated legs and arms.
Others were assigned to the main medical tent. They had 92 badly injured people transported within 30 minutes.
Everybody that left that scene alive in our ambulances is still alive today and on their way to some sort of recovery, we hope.
They witnessed Boston Strong closer than anyone.
How many of you plan to work next year's marathon?
Oh, yeah.
I'm in the same spot, same uniform, same time.
Absolutely.
No question.
First responders didn't get called off the scene until about 11 o'clock that night or later, and days later, they helped with the president's visit, and some were at the scene of the capture in Watertown. All of this in addition to hundreds of regular calls the city gets every day.
We do begin tonight with a Team 5 Investigates exclusive. Newly uncovered text messages sent by one of the accused bombers right after the attack. And Team 5's Kathy Curran is talking to that family tonight.
I have no reason to hate this life here, you know.
Max Mazayev is still searching for answers in the wake of the deadly marathon bombings, allegedly at the hands of two young men his family first met in 2002. The Mazayev family is one of a handful of Chechen families living in Massachusetts. The former Russian doctor owns a senior health and community center in Newton. He gave Tamerlan Zernayev a job as a part-time driver for the elderly and knew Johar as a young boy.
Johar was smart. Smart guy. This one, you know, was not so gifted, I mean, mentally.
Tamerlan. Johar was friends with Max's son, Baudi. And on the afternoon of the bombings, Baudi says Johar sent him a text that said, "Yo, buddy, are you okay, man?" Baudi replied, "Two bombs went off, people losing limbs." Johar wrote, "I automatically thought of you, man, Boston and whatnot. Alrighty, man, stay safe, my man, keep in touch." The Mazayevs were stunned and disheartened when they learned the brothers were accused of the horrific crime.
Not acceptable at all.
Max says the Tsarnaevs were never a religious family. Tamerlan stopped working at the senior center to set aside more time for boxing. Years later, he met his wife, Catherine, and devoted his life to Islam.
His uncle told him, "Leave this Islam alone, go to work, you know, do. First, you have to support your family. After them, try to do something."
Tamerlan's life ended on a Watertown street after a gunfight with police and being run over by his little brother. While the 19-year-old was on the run, Max asked his son to send Johar a text that said in part, "Johar, man, if you can read this, just turn yourself in for the sake of your parents. Don't make it any worse." And Baudi Mazayev says he never received a reply to that text from Johar. The 19-year-old suspect was taken into custody hours later. Baudi tells us he has been interviewed about those texts by the FBI. For Team 5 Investigates, I'm Kathy Curran.
A new turn in Washington.
A major admission from Boston Police Commissioner Ed Davis. When testifying before Congress today, he revealed the FBI did not share information about suspect Tamerlan Tsarnaev until after the shootout in Watertown. Also new, Tamerlan's body, the source of major controversy, has finally been moved from a Worcester funeral home to its final resting place. This, as we learned, 7-year-old Jane Richard has undergone yet another surgery in her battle to recover from the attack that killed her brother. We begin in Washington, D.C., where News Center 5's Sean Kelly is joining us live. So, Sean, some stunning revelations at today's congressional hearing.
Right, and the FBI really didn't take kindly to that testimony. The FBI office in Boston released a statement late this afternoon that said Boston police had the same intelligence that they did about the older brother, the older Tsarnaev, and that it was their responsibility to go find it.
And we owe all of you a debt of gratitude.
Leadership from Boston's police commissioner made a big impression on Capitol Hill. But Ed Davis's answers to questions about intelligence sharing involving accused bomber Tamerlan Tsarnaev troubled members of Congress.
Were you aware of the Russian intelligence warning regarding Tamerlan and the fact that he may travel overseas to meet with extremists?
We were not, in fact, informed of that particular development.
Davis's testimony was measured, and later he avoided direct criticism of the FBI or Homeland Security.
We need to get all the facts on the table and determine who knew what when before we make any determinations.
The Massachusetts Homeland Security Undersecretary said several days before the marathon, Boston's Regional Intelligence Center distributed an intelligence assessment document that raised concerns about the finish line.
It had absolutely nothing to do with a terrorism threat. It was some information about the potential for protesters to disrupt the finish line.
Davis and Undersecretary Kurt Schwartz told Congress the marathon attacks prove funding for more surveillance cameras is needed, but is not a solution.
There's no technical means that you can point to. There's no computer that's going to spit out a terrorist name. It's the community being involved in the conversation.
Now, the surveillance cameras and computer technology will be costly, and the secretary, the undersecretary, and commissioner both said to Congress that the funding they've gotten over the last decade was critical to their response after the marathon and the days that followed, and any cuts to that funding would be harmful to the entire state. Live in Washington, Sean Kelly, WCVB News Center 5.
That is the unforgettable sound of the wild shootout between the marathon bombing suspects and police. And only on 5, the Watertown officers in the middle of that scene are telling their stories for the first time. Team 5 investigates. Kathy Curran reports tonight they faced bullets, they faced explosives, and they faced a pressure cooker bomb.
It was just rapid fire. It was like fireworks going off. I couldn't believe what was happening.
Officer Joseph Reynolds was alone and under fire as he came around the corner on Laurel Street in Watertown after locking eyes on a stolen black Mercedes SUV.
I come around the corner onto Laurel. I see Officer Reynolds in reverse and I hear him say, "Shots fired."
He started walking towards me as he was shooting.
Shots were being fired, explosives launched, and a pressure cooker exploded. These Watertown cops didn't know the men they were up against were marathon bombing suspects Tamerlan and Johar Tsarnaev. The brothers allegedly gunned down MIT police officer Sean Collier hours earlier, carjacked a man in Cambridge, and headed west.
Thought it was a vehicle that was carjacked and a couple of people that didn't want to get caught.
Pulling up, I could hear the gunshots and the explosion.
Sergeant Jeff Pugelis had just finished his shift but rushed to the scene in his family's minivan. Officer Timothy Menton was working a detail around the corner, and Miguel Colon hit the gas from across town. Moments later, Pugelis was in a battle with Tamerlan Tsarnaev, who was only about 6 feet away.
We were exchanging gunfire at each other. Something happened to his pistol. I don't know if he ran out of bullets or if he had a malfunction or what, but I remember him stopping, looking at the gun, and then getting frustrated and throwing the gun at me. I holstered my weapon and chased after him and tackled him.
I know all these guys. I know their families. It's just the fear that I had that one of them was going to get hit is unreal.
Johar Tsarnaev hopped behind the wheel of the SUV and sped towards the officers on the ground trying to handcuff his brother.
At the time, both myself and Sergeant Pugliese are out of ammunition. Neither one of us have one bullet left.
I grabbed Tamlin by the back of the pants and I tried to drag him out of the road. I might have moved him a half a foot or so. And then all of a sudden I could see, once again with my peripheral vision, the headlights were right here in my face. And I rolled back. I think they missed me with that vehicle by maybe an inch or so.
I took a breath. And I was like, oh my God, did this really just happen? Then I started to hear officer down, officer down.
Reynolds and Menton switched to rescue mode and helped MBTA cop Richard Donahue, who was severely wounded. Reynolds grabbed oxygen, Menton applied pressure to the wound and hopped behind the wheel of the ambulance.
It was a very dire situation. I mean, we were all terrified. We thought we had lost him on scene. Luckily, we got him to Mont Auburn as fast as possible, and they were able to save his life.
There's no training that could have ever prepared these officers for what they faced on that April morning, but their experience, instinct, and sense of duty prevailed.
I'm very proud that we were able to stop them.
For Team 5 Investigates, I'm Kathy Curran.
Deadly connections. A man shot and killed by the FBI in Florida, now tied to suspected marathon bomber Tamerlan Tsarnaev. New at 11 o'clock, more evidence of their link to an unsolved triple murder in Waltham.
11 minutes of nonstop news begins with News Center 5, Sean Kelly, who's live at the scene of that gruesome crime. Sean?
Ed and Heather, those murders happened in that house with the porch light on here on Harding Avenue almost 2 years ago. And the suspect in that case, who was in Orlando for the last 2 years at least, had predicted to friends that the FBI would likely be coming for him and that it would probably end badly.
Ibrahim Todashev's ex-wife came to his defense after a fatal confrontation with the FBI in an Orlando apartment. She denied any close ties he had to accused marathon bomber Tamerlan Tsarnaev.
It's like I said, they were not close to each other. They were not friends or anything, so it's just the people that he knew them. But
the FBI linked Tsarnaev and Todashev just one day after the Watertown shootout.
Yeah, that's the exact picture that they were showing us.
Agents repeatedly visited the Austin apartment he listed as home until September 2011. The same month and year of a triple murder in Waltham. Three men left to die with their throats slashed and marijuana and cash sprinkled on their bodies.
They wanted to come and see if there was anything in the mail with like a Russian name on it or anything.
News Center 5 confirmed the men trained together at this Austin martial arts gym.
He used to talk to them, right? Last time he had a connection with the guy was months ago. He just spoke on the phone. After then, he never spoke to him, right?
Agents kept the pressure on Todashev and began targeting him as a suspect in the Waltham murders. Law enforcement sources say he lunged at a Boston FBI agent during a late-night interrogation. Todashev may have been predicting the ending.
But we had a feeling, worst-case scenario, that something like that's going to happen. You know what I mean? And it happened eventually. We to try to avoid it.
And tonight, ABC News is quoting several law enforcement sources who said that Todashev lunged at that FBI agent from Boston with a knife as he was about to sign a confession for the three murders here in Waltham.
Now to a Team 5 investigation. More than $1 billion. That's the price tag that the Department of Homeland Security estimates it has pumped into fusion centers. They are supposed to help prevent terror attacks across the country, but Team 5's Kathy Curran wondered if that investment has paid off.
We tend to respond instead of prevent, and the cost for response is just too costly.
The cost is immeasurable. Four lives lost and hundreds injured. In the wake of the marathon bombings and the trail of violence that followed, the focus turns to what, if anything, could have been done to prevent it. Why local law enforcement claims they were kept in the dark about a federal probe into bombing suspect Tamerlan Tsarnaev.
There's no easy answer to it, but what we do know is we can't continue to do what we're doing.
Robert Riegel is a former senior intelligence officer for the Department of Homeland Security who helped set up fusion centers across the country to analyze and gather information to prevent terror attacks post 9/11. According to documents obtained by Team 5 Investigates, when it comes to tracking possible terror threats, information sharing has been a problem nationwide for years. This federal report revealed concerns that the FBI doesn't provide feedback to fusion centers and that important information may not make it to the feds. Another investigation showed during a 13-month review, no Fusion Center reporting uncovered a terrorist threat. But it says the centers may provide valuable services in fields other than terrorism.
The Fusion Centers on a day-to-day basis deals with prevention of crime, you know, gang activity, human trafficking.
At no time prior to the bombings did any member of the Massachusetts State Police or the Fusion Center have any information or knowledge about the Tsarnaev brothers.
Recent hearings on the Marathon bombings put the spotlight on the information flow problem. Even though there have been success stories in the past with the state's Fusion Center playing a role in the arrests of Rezwan Ferdeyes, who was plotting to fly drones into federal buildings, and Aftab Ali Khan, who was linked to the Times Square bomber. In the case of the Tsarnaevs, the FBI says after being warned by Russian authorities about Tamerlan, the Joint Terrorism Task Force, which includes members of state and local law enforcement, conducted a threat assessment. That information was entered into a database that's accessible by JTTF members and analysts at the state's Fusion Center.
I don't like the idea that something went on in your jurisdiction. We know about it, but you should go try and find it.
So why didn't the information about Tamerlan Tsarnaev trickle down? The case was investigated, closed out, and it didn't raise any red flags. The information was entered into the database along with thousands of other leads. And some say trying to find that information is like trying to find a needle in a haystack.
Sharing information allows people to understand the needle in that haystack if it's something that's a threat. And that kind of two-way information sharing, there's nothing better than that.
Congressman Bill Keating says no one will be able to say if any additional information could have prevented the bombings, but one thing is clear.
The information sharing still, after all these efforts and all the money that was expended, still is not satisfactory.
And Team 5 has also learned the information about Tamerlan Tsarnaev was not shared at the quarterly meetings the FBI has with local law enforcement leaders because, according to the FBI, it didn't rise to the level of concern. For Team 5 Investigates, I'm Kathy Curran.
And we asked Boston police if their department's Joint Terrorism Task Force members were aware of the investigation into Tamerlan Tsarnaev and did not pass that information along to the department. They would not comment. New at 5:30, a major milestone for the North End woman who lost her right leg in the Boston Marathon bombings. Today she was fit with her complete prosthesis and she took the first steps on her road back to a normal life.
It feels fantastic looking down and seeing 2 feet.
It's been 2 months since Roseanne Sedoya lost her right leg in the attack on the marathon. 2 months since a former stranger used a belt as a tourniquet to save her life.
It's the next part of my life, and it means pretty much freedom.
Freedom from months of crutching, as she calls it.
My palms and hands are chafed and sore.
And needing help just to get up 18 stairs into her North End apartment.
I'm looking forward to saying, I'll meet you somewhere, go down the stairs and walk up the street.
And then we're just gonna attach the suction valve there.
Today, Roseanne's testing out her new prosthesis for the first time.
It feels better.
The right fit, alignment, and suspension, how the prosthesis stays on, all critical.
If any of those three things are not in harmony, patient's going to have some issues. I'm just going to pull on the socket here. I mean, that is completely attached to Roseanne's limb.
But today, finally, her first steps.
Good job.
After a couple of trips up and down the parallel bars, Roseanne's a little uneasy.
The knee starts to bend, I get a little nervous because I'm like, when is it going to stop?
But getting the hang of it.
It's awkward, but I guess from what I understand, I'll learn how to be a lot more graceful on it.
Starting tomorrow at Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital, where she'll stay for about a week of intensive therapy.
Getting the prosthesis is really moving me forward to another step of healing, and I really look forward to it.
We look forward to watching your progress, Roseanne. You're doing great. And by the end of her session today at the Next Step Bionics and Prosthetics in Newton, Roseanne was already ahead of the curve in terms of the movement and balance and talking about when she'll get a prosthesis to get her back to running.
Team 5 Investigates uncovering new information tonight about what kind of gun was allegedly used by the Tsarnaev brothers in their shootout with police.
And we're learning more about where exactly that gun came from. Here's Team 5's Kathy Curran with the exclusive details.
But obviously, we know at some point in time, the gun ended up in the hands
of a terrorist. How did that happen?
The Tsarnaev brothers allegedly gunned down MIT police officer Sean Collier and were in a massive firefight with police. It was a trail of terror in the wake of the marathon bombings, but so far only one handgun has been recovered. Sources tell Team 5 Investigates the gun in question was a Ruger 9mm, and it came from Maine. And even though the serial number on the gun was obliterated, investigators were able to identify it. Former acting director of the ATF, Michael Sullivan, tells Team 5 the gun trace data is one way investigators may be able to figure out how it ended up in the hands of the suspects.
Maybe it was from word of mouth. Maybe somebody suggested to him that I know somebody who's selling firearms in Maine. He could have bought it on the streets in the city of Boston or some other community in Massachusetts. He could have used a straw purchaser.
Team 5 looked at the most recent data from the ATF. In 2011, 351 of the guns used in crimes recovered in Massachusetts were from the Bay State. 79 were traced back to Maine. The gun allegedly used by the bombing suspects was recovered in Watertown after police say Tamerlan Tsarnaev threw it at them when it ran out of ammunition or jammed.
It doesn't surprise me that a criminal is able to get access to a firearm no matter how many laws we have in place, either at the federal level or the state level.
And there are still a lot of unanswered questions, but again, sources tell us investigators have made some good progress in tracking this gun to Maine. We reached out to the ATF and the FBI, but no one would comment. For Team 5 Investigates, I'm Kathy Curran.
We have chilling new details tonight in the Boston Marathon attack. An indictment is spelling out the suspect's final sinister moves right before the deadly blast. News Center 5's Sean Kelly is live near the marathon finish line tonight. So, Sean, what have we learned?
At one day before the marathon, Tsarnaev opened an account to a prepaid cell phone. And today, prosecutors revealed that he used that cell phone just seconds before the first explosion, steps away from this marathon site, the finish line here, and he used the phone to call his older brother.
Sometime before his capture, prosecutors say Johar Tsarnaev scrawled clues to the motive for the marathon bombings. A rant written inside the Watertown boat where the 19-year-old hid during the massive manhunt. The U.S. government is killing our innocent civilians, he wrote, according to the federal indictment. I can't stand to see such evil go unpunished. We Muslims are one body. You hurt one, you hurt us all.
They took these acts as an explanation. In some ways to affect what United States foreign policy may be.
Prosecutors say the UMass Dartmouth student also downloaded extremist books about jihad and step-by-step directions for building pressure cooker bombs.
This case is about our community. It's about an assault on our people.
The 30-count indictment against the only surviving suspect includes 17 charges that could result in the death penalty. He faces murder charges for the deaths of Crystal Campbell, Lingzi Liu, Martin Richard, and MIT officer Sean Collier, who authorities say was shot in the head at close range. Both Tsarnaev brothers practiced shooting with 9mm handguns weeks before the attacks.
Tamerlan Tsarnaev's justice will be in the next world, but for his brother, accountability will begin right here in the District of Massachusetts.
They planned for battle. The night of the Watertown shootout, they carried 5 IEDs, a semi-automatic handgun, ammunition, and a machete. MBTA officer Richard Donahue was almost killed.
Just glad to see the justice system is moving to get this case resolved.
Tsarnaev was also indicted on more than a dozen state charges, and so eventually he'll have to appear for an arraignment in a Middlesex County courtroom. And unlike in the federal case, in the state court, that one can be televised. Live in Boston, Sean Kelly, WCVB News Center 5.
From WCVB Channel 5. A broadcast premiere, a history-making concert, Boston Strong, an evening of support and celebration.
The concert sold out in mere minutes.
But more than 2 months after the attack on the Boston Marathon, we're here to show our support for the victims and survivors. Good evening, everyone. I'm Ed Harding.
And I'm Heather Unruh, and we're here overlooking our beautiful, resilient city. Out of the terrible tragedy of April 15th, so much good has followed. Communities grew closer. Strangers became heroes. funds came in from around the world, and we became Boston Strong.
The one fund Boston became the symbol of Boston Strong.
Formed by Governor Deval Patrick and Mayor Tom Menino, more than $60 million in donations has been collected.
But tonight, we have one goal in mind, to get that number even higher.
It's not too late for you to do your part. You can still make a donation to the survivors. Give now at onefundboston.org, and you'll also find a link at WCVB.com. You can make a donation of $10 by texting the word Boston to 80108. Truly every dollar makes a difference.
Tonight, WCVB is bringing you almost 4 hours of an unprecedented concert. Aerosmith, New Kids on the Block, Jason Aldean, Jimmy Buffett, James Taylor, Carole King, all with no commercials. This really is the concert ticket that everyone wanted.
And it's your chance to see it for yourself and give to the survivors and the victims' families. And with more on their stories, here's News Center 5's Liz Bruner.
On the morning of April 15th, none of us knew their names. They were just like us, enjoying the Boston Marathon, feeling the warm sun upon their faces. Now, not only do we feel we know so many of the survivors, their lives are divided into two parts, before and after they survived the attack on the Boston Marathon.
They have become the faces of not just a terrorist tragedy, but of triumph. They are the brothers, Paul and JP.
I feel like myself is just a different normal.
Celeste Corcoran and her 18-year-old daughter, Sydney.
And just telling me that I was gonna be okay.
Jeff Bauman.
Both of his legs were blown off. Jeff's father asking everyone to pray for his son.
The officer.
I've had some challenging days, you know, sleepless nights.
And the dancer.
I said, I think there's something wrong with my foot.
So many survivors, and like the city of Boston, they are broken but not defeated. They are appreciative because they know too well just how close the end was.
His last hours were as perfect as an 8-year-old boy could hope for.
Martin Richard, Lingzi Liu, and Crystal Campbell. In their honor, survivors carry on.
Forward. There you go.
As the days and weeks pass,
put your heel out, feel the knee bend.
Progress doesn't always mean easier.
I live in the North End, so everything is walking. My apartment, I have about 18 stairs up. Those stairs are very difficult to get up.
And that's where Boston's One Fund will help. Within days, millions of your donations will be in the hands of those impacted most, covering long-term care and changes needed for their new realities. For Roseanne Sedoya, that could mean a variety of prosthetics so that she can get back to the active life she loved.
I used to run, I used to go to the gym. I'm gonna need different legs for those situations. It's not just today's leg, it's not just about getting today's prosthesis, it's about a lifetime of having to have these different ones.
When we first met Roseanne.
I can do it. I'm Boston Strong.
And now, thanks to your help, so many survivors have a fighting chance to overcome.
It's been unbelievably amazing, and all I can do is just say thank you. I wish I could thank each one individually because it means so much.
Such a strong reminder that when you give, you're helping survivors like Roseanne Sedoya not only resume a normal life, but resume the normal activities that she's loved for years. You can donate now or anytime at onefundboston.org or follow the link at WCVB.com.
And now the show you've been waiting for. Commercial free, Jay Giles, comedians Lenny Clark, Stephen Wright.
And appropriately, the band Boston, which kicks off the Boston Strong Concert. Enjoy the show.
Boston Mass, we love each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Boston! Give it up for Boys to Men! We love you!
What a show. New Kids with Boys to Men. You know, it's so rare to get so many great acts in one place at one time, and WCVB is proud to be able to bring you the Boston Strong Concert commercial-free tonight.
After this year's marathon, so many of us felt helpless, and if you haven't given yet, this is your chance. Help the victims, their families, the survivors of the attack on our incredible city. It's easy. You can give $10 right now by texting the word Boston to 80108 or donate any amount right now at onefundboston.org. Or there's a link at WCVB.com.
Now, as of this week, more than $60 million have been donated, and on Monday, the first checks from your generous donations tonight will be in the hands of those most impacted. But One Fund is still accepting contributions. Any money that comes in now will still go to survivors. And the point here, and it's critical, it's not too late.
You know, Anthony, as the survivors are healing, the city is healing too. I recently sat down with Mayor Tom Menino. He's still deeply moved, talking about the day Boston's heart was ripped open.
This happened right in the heart of the city on a very special day.
Were there moments after the bombing where you worried about the city, what was going to happen to it?
I was very concerned. On that Friday when the shutdown happened, we had several reports about people with bombs, and that's why we did that. But I was more concerned about how people would react to it.
Of the suspects, he says he doesn't think about them, even in the depths of mourning all that was taken. There was something, Mayor Menino, about the moment where you were handed the flag. What were your emotions in that moment?
I can't explain my emotions. I was all choked up. I didn't know what to say. I just wanted to offer my help, the city's help, my personal help.
Right away, he said he knew he had to do something and knew a single fund would be best. He still worries about the marathon victims' futures, but knows the support, financial and otherwise, will make a world of difference.
It's very special. I've never seen it in all the years I've been mayor. And that's what makes it unique about Boston. The strength of our city is in its people. And it never showed better than during that week and the weeks after. And by showing this on Channel 5, a lot of people see the show, but also help some of the survivors have a better life. It's amazing what you see coming out of these people. Because, I mean, they have more courage than I think I have.
And there they go!
He looks to the next Boston Marathon and sees more security, more runners, but at its heart, the same event so many love.
This is the original marathon. Everybody tries to copy us, and nobody as good as Boston. But we're a special city. There's no other city like Boston.
Mayor Menino is so proud of this city, and he didn't make it to the live concert at the Garden, but he promised me he is watching tonight, so hello, Mayor Menino.
And he will love this lineup. Coming up, James Taylor, Carole King, and Jimmy Buffett. Let's get you right back to the music.